Welcome to Brains Matter, the podcast on science, curiosities, and general knowledge. I'm your host, just an ordinary guy. I hope everyone in the land down under is enjoying Australia Day, Tuesday the 26th of January 2010. Something that's been at the periphery of the media for decades now is the issue of racism. People tend to know it exists. Some people admit to it, others deny they are, but behave otherwise, and most often, people like to pretend it's not there. In today's episode of Brains Matter, we're going to discuss this important issue. I talked to Dr Yin Paradies, a senior research fellow at the University of Melbourne. Dr Paradies' research focuses on the health, social and economic effects of racism, as well as anti-racism theory, policy and practice. Dr Yin Paradies has worked in Indigenous health research for almost 15 years now and is a postdoctoral research fellow at the Menzies School of Health Research at the University of Melbourne. He studies the effects of racism on areas such as health, health research and anti-racism policy. So welcome to the show, Dr Paradies.
Thanks.
So firstly, what got you interested in this area of study?
Well, it was a while ago now, back in 2001. I was just finishing a Master's of Medical Statistics and thinking of what sort of topic I could pursue in my PhD, which I plan to do the next year. And I didn't really have any ideas, but I broadly was interested in the social determinants of health. So very much, you know, things like how factors in our life affect our health, both factors in the hospital context and factors in everyday life. And I came across a very interesting paper by a researcher at Harvard University called Nancy Krieger, Professor Krieger, and it was all about racism as a determinant of health and the kind of research that she had just started quite recently in the US.
Is there a lot of work in that area? Because when you're talking about determinants of health, you'd think of things like social conditions, environmental conditions in terms of socioeconomic background, whether you live in a, you know, multi-million dollar mansion or, you know, middle class suburb, whether you smoke, things like that. So how much research has been done in terms of the racism effect?
Yeah, those are the more traditional kind of approaches to social determinants of health. And there's kind of those kind of underlying conditions that you talked about, like poverty and neighbourhood influencing things like smoking as a behaviour. But more recently, we've seen things like, you know, racism and other sort of concepts like social capital and those kind of ideas have emerged in the last 10 years or so. So racism in particular, really, the first paper wasn't published till the mid-90s.
Okay, so what did you mean by social capital?
Social capital is the idea that the way we're connected to other people in our lives, so how many friends we have, how many people we can depend on in a crisis, the density of our relationships, really, so with other people, how that affects our health directly through the kind of resources we can garner from others, but also in their mental health, our feelings of positivity and self-efficacy and those ideas. So racism, yeah, is one of those more esoteric concepts, I suppose, in the social determinants of health. And as I said, it's very new. And really, even given that started in the mid-90s, it hasn't taken off until, you know, 5 years ago and become a larger area of study. So to date, there's probably around 300 studies or so that have been done in public health in this topic.
As Australians, we'd like to think that we've come a long way since Menzies' era of the White Australia policy. Do you think we have, apart from a policy perspective?
Yes, we have. There's no doubt about that. And all across the world, the nature of racism, and some would say the level of racism that exists, has reduced, but certainly the nature has changed. So we moved from
overt to subliminal.
Yes, from this kind of overt systemic policy legislative based racism to something that's much more implicit. Certainly there are still those systemic, we call systemic racism, so the way that institutions and society, organisations, the way that we operate in a natural kind of fashion, results in inequities for people of different racial and ethnic groups. That still exists, but it's not explicit anymore. And people talk about this idea of old versus new racism. So old racism is ideas of things like biological inferiority and different races shouldn't mix with each other. Those are much less prevalent now than they were in this era.
Mm-hmm.
And instead we have what's called new racism, which is all about difference and groups that don't fit into society, people who shouldn't stick to their old ways but should assimilate more into Australian, called Australian society. So it's much more subtle, and, you know, some would say that's better, but others would say that subtler things can be more damaging in their own right.
There's a bit of irony in some of that, because I hear or read in papers where people say people who come here need to be like us, whatever us is, and yet at the same time people go, well, I love the multicultural aspect of our culture.
Mm, exactly. That's exactly the sort of contradictory sentiments that we found in national surveys on this topic.
I love Chinese food, but they shouldn't come here and cook it or something like that.
Exactly. Not in my backyard anyway. So there's this kind of general support for multiculturalism as an idea, as an abstract, and then there's the specific issues that people have with cultural difference and ways of operating that are kind of different from the dominant Anglo norms that we have in Australia still.
So going back to the health topic, how commonly is racism reported in the healthcare sector?
Well, it's actually in the healthcare sector is probably a place where it's reported to the least extent.
Okay.
So getting back to the idea of social determinants of health, in this field of public health where I work, we're not so concerned with health contexts, even though they are important in their own right. They certainly are not the strongest driver of how healthy people are. It's all those issues to do with how much they earn, their social position, whether they live in a good neighbourhood and have access to the resources that are in that neighbourhood that are promote health, essentially.
Mm-hmm.
So in terms of interpersonal racism, so that's the racism between people, certainly very little has been reported in healthcare contexts, a lot more in places like employment contexts, in people's educational settings where they go, even public places and general service provision, shops, restaurants, there's a lot more racism reported in those places. But having said that, the other side of the story is the kind of systemic stuff I was alluding to earlier. So there's been some studies showing that Indigenous patients receive less care in hospitals. So what I mean by that is they receive fewer what are called procedures, which are just like operations and those sort of things, in hospitals compared to non-Indigenous patients. Mm-hmm. And that's after we account for a range of factors that should influence people's healthcare. So whether they have other conditions when they come in, whether they live in remote or urban areas tends to affect the level of healthcare. Those sort of factors, after accounting for those, we still have this difference, quite a large difference. So Indigenous patients, for instance, are three times less likely to receive kidney transplants, and a third less likely to receive treatment for most other conditions. So when you look at that systemic stuff, it's a real issue in the healthcare setting, but people are not reporting so much in the way of interpersonal racism with their healthcare providers.
With the transplant stuff you were talking about before, can we infer that there are issues such as medical specialists recommending a transplant organ, for example, to someone who they've chosen based on something like race? Like, this person is more like me as opposed to an Indigenous Australian, so therefore I think this person is, in my mind, worth more to me in my society, therefore they will get this heart or something like that.
Yeah, it's a lot of work that's been done in this area of healthcare racism has been in the US. There was a report called Unequal Treatment that came out of the Institute of Medicine probably about 5 years ago now. And they showed that a lot of the effect that in terms of physicians and clinicians is really very implicit. So there's this test that they use called the implicit association test, which is a psychological computer-based test you can do. And it essentially tells you how much unconscious racism you have. And they've shown that this unconscious racism is associated with the way that healthcare providers recommend treatment,
mm-hmm.
usually in scenario-based sort of tests. So they say, here's a couple of scenarios, this patient's African-American, this patient's white, and they see these differences. So it is that. It's kind of it's much more implicit than conscious, but it's more about that idea of, can this person benefit from this treatment Mm-hmm. So who can benefit more? And that comes a lot into things like transplants. So some of those are legitimate concerns, but others are assumptions, unfounded assumptions based on race that don't actually relate to the needs or the abilities of that patient to benefit. So there's been a bit of work done on that. There's a big study called the Impact Study looking at kidney disease in Indigenous Australians, and recommendations are around improving communication and cross-cultural understandings for clinicians, and trying to think about how people can become more aware of some of those implicit assumptions that they may hold and apply. And that's really one of the key things about racism these days, is it is very subtle and a lot of awareness raising to be done in terms of helping people understand that implicit nature of racism.
What are some of the other effects of racism in the healthcare sector? We've talked about transplants as one example. The other thing that comes to mind for me, and this could be implicit or conscious as well, is the care provided by nursing staff, for example. One of the big effects, and you could talk about the psychological effects of your treatment and how that helps you get better, is if you feel like you're more cared about, you're more valued as a patient, then the outcomes of that versus if you're just given your medicines at your appropriate intervals and not much chat and that sort of thing.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I'll answer that before broadening it out a little. In the healthcare context, certainly the studies that have been done have shown that more perceived racism by patients is associated with lower satisfaction with their care. So mm-hmm. they're not satisfied with their care, but also patients tend to be less willing to adhere to the medications that they're given. So it has negative effects on their willingness to kind of cooperate with the system and, mm-hmm. and their providers. And also there's evidence that people are less likely to go in for healthcare. It's all very, very obvious. If you're not being treated very well, you're not going to turn up, you're not going to take your medications, and you're not going to be very happy mm-hmm. when you're there. But broader than that, taking once again that public health perspective, we can see a few key ways that racism affects people's health more broadly. So probably the strongest effect, but the most difficult to measure, is the way that racism affects people's life chances. So if you experience racism in employment or education or housing or medical care for that matter, what happens is that you're generally missing out on opportunities, resources, kind of abilities to get ahead in life. So that systemic effect through those pathways, so poor education is associated with worse health, mm-hmm. those sort of effects will lead to poor health. The other way is through stress. So a lot of evidence of the effects of stress on people's health, both their mental health and the various physical systems of the body. So stress affects immune functioning, it affects our metabolic system and other physiological outcomes. So racism has, not surprisingly, been strongly associated with stress and negative emotions and cognitions or ways of thinking. So that's another way it affects health. And then there's the kind of internalisation of stigma and negative beliefs about your own racial group that mm-hmm. occurs if you're exposed to too much of that. And they're kind of another flow-on effect is a lot of people end up being very anxious about experiencing further racism, so they become what's called vigilant or have what's called anticipatory anxiety of thinking about when they might next experience racism, what they can do to avoid it before they go out, what places in their life they can avoid so they don't have to put up with that sort of behaviour, and it's the effect that has on people's lives.
It's almost conditioned into people, isn't it? Is that I can relate an example of that. I was in the US a few years ago. I was in a hotel from a very well-known hotel brand, which I won't name, and the porter was an African-American, and I was wearing an Australian football jumper, and he was doing the polite thing, and he said, "Oh, that's a very colourful jumper you've got there, sir," as part of what his job is, make small talk with the guests. So I turned around to him and I, being a typical Aussie, just said, "Yeah, it's Aussie rules football. Have you heard about Aussie rules football before?" And the first reaction he had, and wasn't stated, but it was just something that you can see in that someone's reaction, was, "Why are you talking to me? I'm a porter, you're a guest." Mm. And it was almost like almost self-inflicted class system. Mm. And that he didn't expect me to respond and converse with him. And I conversed with him for the next 10 minutes and I explained about Australian rules football. No, it's not rugby. No, it's not soccer. It's a totally different game. There are 16 teams and my team is from Western Australia and blah, 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 and a few things like that.
Yeah, yeah.
And in 5 minutes, we were talking like, you know, just like you talk to anybody you meet as a friend. But the first couple of minutes, he just looked at me with a great deal of suspicion. It wasn't because I'd treated him badly before. It's just that there was that expectation.
Yes, yes, exactly. And it brings up interesting issues in the literature around how racism intersects with things like classism and sexism, and there's what are called intersecting oppressions and effects that have very different effects for people, you know, who are African-American women compared to African-American men, and the way that different forms of racism occur and different forms of racism are more common in certain settings for the people of different genders. Yeah, there's a lot going on there. But that's the sort of stuff, yeah. And I guess to finish that, that at least a lot of people, there's significant evidence now in the literature showing the kind of negative behaviours that people take up from the stress of racism.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, racism has been associated with high rates of smoking and high rates of alcohol consumption, drug use, as well as difficulties participating in healthy behaviours like exercise and having a good night's sleep, for instance. And finally, as we've seen in Victoria recently, racism can result in actual physical injuries through racially motivated assaults. So there's a whole range of pathways and only a small amount of research really for some of those.
Have you found in general racism can be segmented, I guess, so geographically versus socially, so people in sport versus academia versus school versus the rest of society, for example. So some of the examples you were giving before, someone in a rural area or impoverished area, the amount of racism they experience from the rest of society versus that same type of individual within on the sporting field. You know, in Australia, for example, there's you know, historically there's been a fair amount of racism against the native population.
Sure.
And people have, you know, there are jokes and there are attitudes about people in Northern Territory or Western Australia and living in their communities and so on. Yet that same person, put them on the AFL football field and they're suddenly a hero. Have you found that the amount of racism varies depending on context as well?
Yes, it does vary. And let me just add at this point that a lot of this research hasn't been done by me. Obviously, there's a lot of other people involved in this area.
Mm-hmm.
And one of my colleagues, who's now at the University of Western Sydney, has done a lot of research, survey research on racist attitudes and behaviours and experiences of racism across the country. And he's found that racism varies a great deal by geography, so even to very small levels. So from one sort of local government area, you know, say where local councils operate, to the next one, you'll find quite large differences in the way people are racist. So certain groups have higher levels of racism directed against them in one area and not the case in the adjacent suburbs.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, broadly speaking, it is true that urban areas tend to have less racism than rural ones, but the variation is so enormous it's really a bit of a misnomer to use that generalisation. So it's huge.
Can we determine from that that where there is less racism, there is less of a differential between the quality of healthcare received? So, for example, the quality of healthcare from someone who might experience poorer healthcare in a rural area because of the attitudes there versus in a metro area because they might have slightly better attitudes, for example? Or is it reasonably even across the board? Or is that yet to be determined?
I think that has yet to be determined, yes. I don't think anyone's actually done research like that. It's mostly been separate research, so looking just at the prevalence, how much racism there is across geographies, rather than trying to look at the associations with some of those outcomes. But that would be good.
And let's take a short break and go to listener of the episode. Today's listener of the episode is Margaret Turner from Australia. I hope you're enjoying the show, Margaret.
And there's lots of research like that to be done still, especially in Australia. So there's the motto of that group. It's called the Challenging Racism Surveys. You can find that online. Is really that racism is everywhere different, and that comes from that great deal of segmentation geographically. But in terms of settings, and I alluded to some of that earlier, so healthcare, not so much. Racism is reported in healthcare, but a lot of racism is reported in places like workplaces, for instance, in educational settings, in housing contexts, in service provision, including also the criminal justice system. People report a fair degree of racism from police and other aspects of that system. Yeah, some of those survey results show basically about a quarter to a third of people are reporting racism in those key settings, mm-hmm. and much less in other ones like healthcare, for example. And also some evidence that it's kind of less in what's called informal settings, especially for Indigenous people. So less racism in public places and service provision compared to those formal settings of education, employment, and so on. But still, you know, significant levels, you know, a quarter to a third of people in any particular setting.
Is this an issue that's about the same in Australia compared to the rest of the world, or is it worse here, or is it worse elsewhere? How do we fit in the grand scale of things?
Yes, well, there's not exactly a league table of these things, and probably would be a bad idea if there was, because of that variation in kind of expressions and form of racism, even within one country. But broadly speaking, with what data we have that we can compare between countries, Australia does pretty well.
Mm.
We do better than most European countries, tend to have stronger negative attitudes to immigrants in particular. But we probably don't do as well as a couple of places, Canada and New Zealand, which are similar, very similar contexts to us, and also have a similar kind of multicultural policy, but they seem to do better on this kind of attitude surveys at the moment. We probably do better than the US. They have fairly high levels of racism. But it's a very broad brush, and it's encouraging for Australia, and it just shows that we need to continue leading out on this sort of work and see what we can learn from other places who are doing better.
The work that you've been discussing, how has this informed public policy?
Not enough so far. We're trying to inform public policy through a framework to reduce race-based discrimination in Victoria. That's almost finished, and that's got some interest from government, and certainly there's work to be done in that area in Victoria. So we're hoping to implement the findings from that framework from next year onwards.
Can you talk about some of those findings, or...?
Sure, yeah. So the framework is really about reviewing what evidence we have on effective kind of principles and actions to address racism. So some of the key findings are really about conflict resolution skills are very important in addressing racism at the personal level, increasing empathy for other people and other groups in society. There's a need to dispel false beliefs and myths about other groups. A small part of it, but it's a step in the right direction. And there's a whole other body of work that's around positive contact and relationships with other people. So there's certain principles we can use to promote positive contact between racial and ethnic groups, helping people to learn about each other, and also move towards a more nuanced common identity. So how can we create this sense of Australian identity that's more inclusive?
And one of the criticisms I hear about that is, and this is just one example, is through media. So, for example, the average soapy, they're always, you know, blonde and blue-eyed and so on. And I remember reading something in one of the entertainment newspapers a little while ago, and it was a writer who actually had an Italian background. They were actually writing for, I think it was... the Sullivans or the Young Doctors or one of those old 70s Australian soaps,
yeah.
for those who are listening overseas. And they had a character called Puccelli or something, and there was a line which says something like, we have to go to Puccelli's farm to get that, and the producers changed that, we have to go to Macca's farm to get it, because it was seen as too ethnic.
Yes. Exactly, and the media is one of the areas that has been studied in terms of this kind of discourses of race and racism, and certainly it's one of the culprits. You know, you have that homogeneity of characters, mm-hmm. and evidence of, you know, underreporting of positive stories about ethnic minorities and even the news media, and kind of it's all negative, kind of conflict-based kind of reporting. Even just shots, you know, that they have of crowds, you just don't get that diversity that you should in Australia. That's moving on to the kind of settings-based stuff that we have in the framework, and trying to address some of that systemic racism in the media. You know, what sort of policies can we institute in educational contexts? There's you know, some examples of appropriate kind of curricular changes we can make, and ways to promote this kind of intergroup contact and cooperative learning approaches that help people basically become familiar with other groups in a positive way. And the other side of it is really about organisational change. So how can we understand the way that systems create these inequities, these avoidable and unfair inequities that are racist? So some work overseas in places like the UK, what's called positive duties on organisations to understand what sort of disparities they're creating, and mechanisms to audit that and review and improve their practice, both for their staff and clients. So, yeah, the anti-racism framework will be available from the Vic Health website. Vic Health is actually, that stands for the Victorian Health Promotion Foundation. They're probably the leading organisation in Australia looking at racism as a determinant of health and ways to address it. So I've been working with them on this framework. And as I said, it highlights this kind of principles and strategies, as well as case studies that are promising from overseas and nationally. So hopefully we can get some policy traction with that sort of work. Recently, there has been more interest in this topic on the national agenda. Bodies like the Australian Multicultural Advisory Council, which have been recently formed, have a key focus on addressing racism and intolerance. The Department of Immigration and Citizenship kind of revamped their program and now has an explicit focus on dealing with racism, and they have co-funded some intervention work that's starting up this year as well. So it's a work in progress, but it seems positive at the moment.
So here's a bit of an interesting, hairy question. Where do you think racism comes from? Because some would argue that it's not a natural behaviour. Some argue that it is because it's a instinctual tribal thing, and some argue that it's not, because you have examples of, you know, kids playing quite happily with each other no matter what background they're from, and the ideas of difference tend to be introduced to them by adults. And I even remember reading in David Suzuki's biography, the famous naturalist and scientist from Canada. He grew up in Canada during World War II, and there was a passage in his biography which was talking about an incident where his father was... Japanese Canadians were separated out and put into camps in case there were spies and what have you. And that was done quite commonly during World War II. But the children all went to the same kindergarten. And so David was in kindergarten playing with one of his friends when his dad rode past on a bicycle and waved at him and said, "Hi, David." And of course, David waved back, and his friend turned around and said, "Do you know him? What are you waving at him for? He's a Jap." Mm. Without realising that he looked exactly the same except older than his friend.
Mm. Yes. So
that, to me, that would imply that that's something that was pointed out to that young boy by his parents or relatives, to say that person over there is a Japanese, so therefore all people who look like this are the enemy. And he didn't correlate that to his friend, who is a small version of the same look.
Yes. Well, actually, there's a lot going on there. Certainly there is a natural tendency for humans to categorise into groups. So we tend to easily form what's called in-groups, and the rest of everyone else being out-groups, or the out-group. And that's been proven in laboratory settings with very, very, it's called the minimum group paradigm. So you basically just tell people, look at this screen with random dots on it. Tell me, you know, how many dots you see that look like this. It's just made up, basically. And they randomly assign them into groups, and they have them do activities, and very soon they start to favour their own group members and derogate the other group members. So there's a strong tendency to form groups, and probably has some sort of evolutionary / genetic basis to it. But that doesn't have anything to do with race in particular. So why is race one of the groups of interest It's not a natural tribal sort of grouping in this day and age. Yeah, your in-group, if you say your in-group is where you live, it consists of people of all different races and ethnicities, generally.
I haven't actually seen a decent definition of what race is, because it's a construct from 1800s European scientists who did the old white Caucasians versus Negroids versus the Mongoloids, which were the three main ones they used. And under Caucasoids, you had your Australoids, which are like Native Australians and so on, and all these groupings that they understood, quote, for about 100 years or so, and then science over the last 50 years has shown us that all of that is bunk, and it means absolutely nothing. It's the same as a green parrot versus a blue parrot. It's just a different colouring or different features based on the way particular groups have evolved in their geographic location. And, you know, that's one view of race. Another one is what your nationality is. Another one is what your religion is. You go to America, the list of race has a mix of, in the forms that you fill in, has a mix between traditional race, nationalities, like Hispanic is suddenly a race, whereas, oh, hold on, in the old view, that would have been Caucasian. Indians are Caucasians, but oh, hold on, they're now South Asians, and then you have Orientals, and then you have Jews, but hold on, that's a religion. What is race? I still don't understand what it is.
It's complicated. It's a social category, same as ethnicity and religion, which are very much implicated in race these days. And certainly in the work that we've done, for instance, in this framework, we've lumped those together, race, ethnicity, culture and religion, under that one sort of broad idea of difference. So race is not a biological or genetic category. There's no valid way to partition humanity into biological races. It's just not a valid concept. But it's a social concept, and people use it every day in their lives. And
they all use it differently, which makes it differently,
which is the nature of humans as well. That's a tendency of humans too. Difference. So given that race has a very social meaning, I guess the point is that, yes, humans like to differentiate and probably form hierarchies based on that differentiation. Certainly primates have a lot of that. But the notion of race is a very complex human social idea, and it hasn't always existed. So its origin is variously ascribed from as early as, you know, classical antiquity or soon after to the 15th century and European colonisation as the first kind of real solid foundation for the idea of race. So race hasn't always been, and so it doesn't always have to be. And it's based on ideas of exclusion, but it's much more complex ideas of relatedness and essentialism. And the thing is, the point I wanted to make about kids is that being within a society that is racialized and racist, you know, is something that they learn about at a very early age. So there's been studies showing that 6 months old babies can have differential reactions to people of different races. So as early as that, as people, children are starting to learn about what race means. And your example from the kinder in Canada was kind of illustrates some of the steps that kids go through in their ability, based on their cognitive ability. You know, so studies have shown that kindergarten kids have ideas of race, even adult-like ideas of race in the abstract, but they're very bad at actually telling which person is in which race. They just don't know. So they, in your example, they have racist opinions of certain groups, but they don't know that their friend is a member of that group. It's well demonstrated in the research. There's plenty of opportunities to engage kids in programs that encourage them to see people as the same and different, and encourage them to translate their strong ideas of right and wrong, which they have as early as three, into notions of race, so their ideas of morality, and applying that to race. So, yeah, race comes from somebody invented race at one point, and now it's quite pervasive, but there are ways to address it.
So, as a final question, you're given $10 million in funding to do as you please. How would you allocate that funding to deal with this issue?
Well, what I would do is I'd set up a race relations institute in Australia. They have one in Canada, and the US has a kind of an organisation of that name that's somewhat different. The goal of this institute in Canada, and the goal that I would have for Australia, is simply a elimination of racism in Australia. And that's not a simple thing at all, but that would be the goal. And also promoting diversity and the benefits of diversity to Australia. And there are many benefits of diversity, economic and social. So, yeah, I'd use that $10 million as an endowment. I'd set up an institute and allocate kind of funding to further research, as well as really trying to translate what we know into policy and practice. So leveraging government bodies and processes to try and get some of these anti-racism ideas instituted as well.
Dr. Yin Paradies, thank you very much for your time today.
Thank you. My pleasure.
And I hope you found that interesting. And don't forget, Brains Matter is having a live show at 2 p.m. on Saturday the 13th of February at Borders Bookstore in Lygon Street, Carlton. So for those listeners in Victoria, Australia, feel free to come on by and bring along a friend as well to join in the fun. And now it's time for some listener feedback. Harold Goldner from Pennsylvania in the US wrote and said, I love your podcasts. I've been following a little less than a year and download almost every one of your podcasts. Thanks for that, Harold. Reese Winter from Melbourne in Australia wrote, I've been a big fan since learning of your podcast when you had your first 365 days of astronomy podcast. With all the science and astrophysics podcasts I listen to, I can't believe I've missed one of the best and from my own hometown. Keep up the great work. Thanks for that feedback, Reese. And from Kylie Sturgis in Perth, Brains Matter is one of those special shows that reflect how great research leads to excellent content. This podcast covers a wide range of science, technology and scepticism topics that are definitely showcased in interviews by its host, The Ordinary Guy, who is anything but ordinary with his enthusiasm. Very educational one to keep subscribing to. And that was one she put on to the iTunes as music store in Australia. So thanks for that, Kylie. And thanks to everybody for their comments. I'll leave you with a quote from Louis Pasteur. There are no such things as applied sciences, only applications of science. Bye for now. Thanks for listening to the show. You can check out the Brains Matter website at www.brainsmatter.com. That's www.brainsmatter.com. And you can find all the other episodes of the show there. Just click on the podcast link on the right hand side. You can listen to the episodes from your browser by choosing Flash Player from the links and selecting whichever episode you want to hear from within the player. There's also other information on the site, such as links to articles and news, subscription details, both via iTunes and manually, and voting information. Please vote for the podcast on Podcast Alley, and remember to vote every month, since the votes reset at the start of each month. If you want to support the show, have a look at the Support the Show link. You can make a donation via PayPal, or you can buy a book through one of the Amazon links on the support page. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can leave an entry on this episode's show notes on the webpage, or you can send me an email. All my contact information can be found on the site. The theme music Future is performed by Cut Copy and comes courtesy of Glenn Gertz from Modular Records. I hope you enjoyed the show. Bye for now.